can't tell you, we've worked so hard. I haven't worked that hard. Semper's worked very hard. It's been truly a blessing. You know, the one thing I really appreciate is that when Sema, when she came to class with me, when we were gathered together, she never brought this thing with her.
Amen.
She didn't, like, plug it in. Even though I'm pretty sure Sema knows that if she has any questions about life, she just dials it into this thing, and all the questions come right back at us. All the answers. Everything we need to know is right here. I mean, we're in such a plugged-in world. I was reflecting that when we usually have a family dinner at home, at least when my children were much younger, we would have conversations around the table.
Yes.
We would say, hey, how's it going? What did you hear today? What happened in school? What's the weather? And then there would be a conversation that would happen. There'd be like a discussion. Oh, I don't know. What do you think? And we'd go back and forth. But nowadays, when someone brings up a question, somebody whips out their phone. So it used to be, hey, what's the weather like tomorrow? I don't know. What did you hear? Oh, I don't know. What do you think? Oh, I don't know. Is the sun up, sun down? What color is it? None of that. Now it's, oh, weather says 62, probably sunny. And that's the end of the conversation. Right? Everything we need to know comes through on our phones. And I've been told that if you're in a situation where you have the same question, the same problem over and over again, there are things called apps. And there are apps on your phone, and you keep having the same situation. And so I looked, and I did find an app for me. And if any of you know, I have this thing about flying. I don't particularly like it. I do it, but I'm usually not happy about it while I'm flying. Well, I found an app, and it's called Am I Going Down? And I plug in there the airport that I'm leaving from, Philadelphia, and I plug in the airport that I'm going to be landing at, Omaha, Nebraska, because we're going to visit my son out in the Midwest. And I have to plug in the type of airline, and then the type of plane. And then it popped back and it says, you have a 1 in 5,124,275 chance of dying. So I literally could win the lottery like twice before I get there. That gives me a sense of comfort when I'm on the plane. It even says that if I take the same flight every day, once a day, I will live to be 14,039 years old before that plane goes down. Now I'm all comforted. I have no problem flying because I can just look it up. I am a little scared to see what happens when the chances, like, you know, change, but we're not even going to think about that because I just plug it in here and it gives me lots of comfort even though my family makes lots of fun of me. We like to be comforted, don't we? We like the feeling of being comforted. For some people, it's that feeling after the Thanksgiving dinner. That's a lot of comfort in our bellies. For others, it's just to have a good open ear or someone to lend a shoulder. We like to be comforted. And there really isn't anything on this that you can't search. In fact, if you go on your phones or you go on your desktops or whatever, your iPads, you go on the internet, you Google what does God look like, hundreds of thousands of images come up of men, and they're black, and they're yellow, and they're white, and they're young, and they're old, and some are neatly trimmed with, you know, the big hair swath. Some are straggly, they've got lots of beard, and some of them are gray, and some of them are young, and they're all sorts of images of God. And they're images that relate to an image that we're already comfortable with, at least for the most part. It's an image that we've been almost trained to think about what God looks like. It's an image that resonates with us. And it's all based upon this overuse and very stereotypical pronoun that we hear in scriptures. That pronoun is he. He. Now, it was used many years ago when the context of that pronoun was very, very different. But today, we tend to use that pronoun only to talk about gender. Not what the scriptures were really using it for. And the problem with being stereotypical, do you know what stereotypical means? It's the overuse of an image or a definition that may not be factual about a person or a thing. It's the overuse of something that may not be accurate. I don't know about you, but I certainly don't want to oversimplify God. Now, this use of he, it's a pronoun that we hear and we use and we repeat and we read, and it kind of dwells into us. And that's what gives us this image that we see of God on the internet. But there are lots and lots of scriptures that speak about a more feminine quality of God. Our scripture for today from Isaiah, the prophet Isaiah, he's reaching out and he's speaking the words of God. So it is God speaking to the entire nation of Israel. Now, this is a time when the nation is just coming back from exile. They had been overthrown by the Babylonians. They were moved out of their homes and out of their neighborhoods. Years, 50 to 75 years, they're in exile. They now come back to their homeland. And through the prophet Isaiah, God says to them, this is what the Lord says. I will extend peace to you like a river, and the wealth of nations flooding like a stream. You will nurse, and you will be carried on her arm, and you will be dangled from her knees. As a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you. And you will be comforted over all of Jerusalem. That's a beautiful image of God doing something that most of us would say is a more feminine quality. Now, there's also some who would say, oh no, God is not just a heavenly father, he's also a heavenly mother. And that's an oversimplification too, because we can't take God and put him into a gender, either male or female. God is not either or, and he's not and. God is in. Remember the words we spoke about previously, that God abides. That doesn't mean he lives next to or next door. That means God lives within us. And what God does in God is God exemplifies for us the very best paternal qualities, the things we associate with a father. But he also exemplifies us the best maternal qualities that we can find. In Deuteronomy chapter 32, Moses is speaking. Now, you have to know what Moses is about to do, because Moses is giving a tongue lashing to the entire nation. The entire nation has gone astray. They've gone wrong. And now Moses is really mad. And this is what he says. You were unmindful of the rock that bore you. You forgot the God who gave you birth. That is a deep maternal quality that he is using. In Psalm 22, King David, he's crying out in despair at his loss, and he uses words that may sound familiar to you from some other place in Scripture. David cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me? It's the same words that Jesus cries out on the cross later. And David cries out these words in this psalm, and then he remembers, and he says, wait, yeah, it was you who took me from my womb. You kept me safe like a child on a mother's chest. Even in the Gospel of Matthew, in chapter 23, in the New Testament, this is a time when Jesus is now grieving. And Jesus is struggling because people are not following him. They're not listening to his word. They keep turning from him. And so Jesus in prayer cries out, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it. How often have I desired to gather you as children, to bring you together as a hen gathers her brood under her wing. He's crying out with maternal instincts to protect them, comfort them, and guide them. These images are passages that speak very loud to us. They speak loud about God's comfort. Just like a good mother comforting her children. Now, I know right now there's some dads here, they're probably getting a little antsy with me. Because I didn't include dads. And yes, dads have very tender qualities. And dads can comfort and guide and do all those things as well. And children need the tender quality of a dad in their lives, but they also need the maternal quality. They need that loving, caring comfort that they've come to know and even expect. But I think sometimes when we think about children, we think about, oh, we're children of God, and therefore we're the same. But in these passages, God's not speaking to children. He's not speaking to any kids. He's only speaking to adults, full-grown, mature adults who are supposed to be able to handle themselves. Adults who are supposed to be able to take care of themselves. But see, God recognizes that as children, the pain that we have that needs comfort, that can often be provided by, like, a hug and a kiss. That can be provided by a tap on the head, or maybe just a listening ear, and that will make things better. But for adults, for groups of adults, and for nations, as sometimes God speaks to, our pains are deeper than that. The pain of loss that we feel in this world, the fear of violence that we have, the reality of the world in our face every day, it requires a little different kind of comfort. But it longs for us to be in that same kind of expectation, that same comfort that each of us felt when we were little. You know, the kiss and the band-aid, and it made all go away. I think that's why mothers now know, as they get more experienced with having children, that comforting a child doesn't disappear when they graduate high school. It doesn't disappear when they graduate college. It doesn't disappear when they get married or when they have children of their own. You and I still go back to our own mothers, and our children still go back to us. And we all desire that comfort that we felt as a child. So exactly how does God do this? How does God comfort us like a mother? Well, first of all, I believe he does it through his presence. His never-ending presence. His presence that's with us every day, every waking moment, even when we sleep, all the times that we are breathing. Psalm 139 says this, "Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? I cannot." Even the first letter to John, chapter 4, it says, "If we love one another, then God abides in us." God is with you all the time. And all the time that God is with us, his love is perfected in us. His mere presence comforts us if we call upon him. But it's not just his presence. You know, God is also a God of great action. His direct action in the world also provides us great comfort. The scriptures say, when my anxieties multiply, your comforting, it calms me down. Psalm 94. Your actions comfort me. And through our scriptures, as we continue to read and study and pray upon them, then we get to see that God's reign is over the entire earth. And we understand that God reigns all that is in the earth. And then we get confidence because God deals with everything in the earth. Even the things, the times when we are wronged, the inequities that we look at, even when people shout out, "How could God allow that to happen?" God is active in all of those things. Now the problem for you and I is, God doesn't necessarily let us in on the plan. He doesn't necessarily tell us what he's up to. He doesn't let us know when he's doing whatever he's doing. We don't know how he's going to heal people or how he's going to deal with inequities or how he's going to handle violence. Sometimes we get a glimpse of it, and sometimes we are so grace-filled to be there when that happens, but other times it may not happen until after we're long gone. But scriptures tell us we can have the confidence that God is working every day in this world. And he's doing it to provide us the comfort that we need. So he not only comforts us through his presence in our lives every day and his actions in our lives every day, but he does something that I think is truly incredible. And when I get to see it as a third party, when I get to stand back and witness this in the world, I see God's grace flowing. And that's when God uses you. When God uses others to provide comfort in this world. When God brings you someone on a really bad day who just lends an ear, when you get that phone call or that text message, or when you get a card in the mail and it picks you up, when you're having a bad day, you can reach out to someone and they listen. When you get a flat tire on the side of the road and a complete stranger stops by and helps you to fix it, that's God being in the world for another person, to give you comfort, to make things just a little bit easier. I'm so amazed when I get to sit back and see how that works in the world. And I often hear of it this way: she was a godsend. Did you ever hear that story? She was a godsend. Someone will say to a complete stranger, "You were a godsend today." Yes, literally, God sent them into your life. God can also do the same for you as well. If we're listening, we can be the ones who give comfort to someone else. We can be the ones who answer that nudge. It's, "Oh, should I stop or should I keep going? Oh, I should call my friend today. Oh, I should just write a quick note to someone. Oh, I should probably just shut up and listen and be the comfort in the world." God gives us great comfort through his presence, his direct action in the world, and using us to be comfort to others. Today is Mother's Day. And I'm sure there's some gathered here today who can remember how Mom used to do so much for us. All the comforting hugs, all the things that she would do for us. And today's the day we send cards and flowers and we make breakfast and we do all the great things that we can do because we are so thankful for our moms. We're thankful for their love and their care. We're thankful for their sacrifice. And we're glad that we are children who had mothers just like that. But there's also some of us here today who may have not had that earthly experience. There may be some here today who have lost their mom, and their mom isn't here to do that. Or perhaps when they were young, their mom became estranged. Or perhaps their mom wasn't called to do those particular things. And it doesn't quite fit the description of a mother comforting a child. And we wouldn't want to wish that on anyone to have that experience. But what we do know is that Scripture has given us the best experience. The best experience of maternal love and comfort. And in that, all of us come to know what it means to be a mom. A mom just like God. A God who loves us and comforts us no matter what. And so today is the day for us to be thankful and to be grateful. Thankful to our earthly moms and grateful to God for giving us moms. And so today, even if you're feeling a sense of loss, or if you're feeling a sense of warmth and love because you're together, know that it is God's comfort that made that happen. Now, I don't know about you, but I'm not going to look for an app on what it means to feel God's love. I'm just going to look out at you, and then I'm going to feel God's love. Today.